지금부터 2020 국제 특허법원
From now on,
컨퍼런스 세 번째 세션을
We'd like to start the third session.
밖에 계신 분들은 모두 입장해 주시기 바랍니다.
All the participants staying outside, please come to the conference room.
세 번째 세션에 참가하시는 연사분들께서는
Speakers of the third session, please come to the stage.
잠시 안내 말씀드리겠습니다. 곧 세 번째 세션을
We will shortly begin
하겠습니다.
the third session.
이번 세션은 디자인 소송의
The third session is about major issues in design litigation.
좌장으로
Presiding Judge Yoon Sung-sik from the Patent Court of Korea will be the moderator for the third session. Speakers of the third session, please prepare yourselves for The third session,
이번 세션은 디자인 소송의 주요 쟁점이라는 주제로
we'll be talking about the major issues in design
litigation. 좌장으로 세션 이끌어 주시겠습니다. 큰 박수 부탁드리겠습니다.
We'll be moderating the session. Please welcome them with a big round of applause.
예, 그럼 지금부터 오후 컨퍼런스를 시작하겠습니다. 저는 조금 전에 소개받은 특허본에 근무하는 윤성식 판사입니다. 이번 세션의 주제는 디자인 소송의 주요 쟁점으로서 디자인 사건에서 주로 많이 문제되는 디자인의 불품성, 디자인의 유사 및 창작비 용이성을 다룰 예정입니다. 먼저 주제와 관련된 질의와 답변 시간을 가진 후에 이어서 화상 디자인에 대한 발표를 듣겠습니다. 그리고 시간이 허락하는 범위 내에서 플로어의 질문을 받겠습니다. 그럼 먼저 이번 세션의 발표자들을 소개해 드리겠습니다. 소개할 때마다 큰 박수로 맞이해 주시면 감사하겠습니다. 먼저 이 자리에 참석하지 못하셨지만 멀리 영국에서 온라인으로 실시간 참석하고 계신 UCL 석좌 교수 겸 변호사로 계시는 제임스 빌 변호사님입니다. 박수 부탁드립니다. 현지 시간으로 아침 이른 시간임에도 불구하고 직접 참석해주신 점에 다시 한번 감사드립니다. 다음은 이 자리에 참석하신 분들을 소개해드리겠습니다. 먼저 특허법원의 정택수 부장판사님입니다. 다음은 특허법원의 권순민 부장판사님입니다. 다음은 중국 잉커 외국 법률 외국 법률 자문 사무소의 축치영 변호사님입니다.
축치영, the attorney from Inca Law Firm.
이어서 특허청 생활 디자인 심사과 과장으로 근무하시는 김지맹 과장님입니다.
Mr. Kim Ji-meng, the director from the Korea Patent Office.
그리고 비록 이 자리에는 참석 못하셨지만 사전 제작된 영상으로 참석하고 계신 두 분을 소개해드리겠습니다. 먼저 일본 지적 재산권 재판소에 계시는 토시히코 츠루오카 부장판사님과 미국 연방 제3항소법원의 켄 조단 판사입니다. 역시 박수 부탁드리겠습니다.
From the US Court of Appeals for the Third Circuit.
예, 그럼 바로 3세션을 시작하도록 하겠습니다. 먼저 디자인의 물품성에 대한 논의로 세션을 시작할 텐데요. 먼저 양해 말씀드리면 시간적 제약을 인해서 패널분들께서는 사전에 말씀드린 시간 범위 내에서 답변해 주시면 감사하겠습니다. 본격적인 시작에 앞서서 미국의 조던 판사님께서 보내주신 특허법상 디자인 특허의 요건에 대한 요약 설명을 들어보도록 하겠습니다.
3 regarding similarity of design patents. It's an honor to be here virtually with my fellow panelists. I hope someday we can be together in person. I understand we're speaking about countries' comparative standards for obtaining and enforcing design protection, such as similarity between designs, ease of creation, and functionality. I'll be sharing a brief overview of the requirements for obtaining a design patent in the United States and highlighting a few of the underlying standards associated with those requirements, including a design's requisite relationship with an article and how the United States assesses similarities between designs in consideration for issuing a design patent and determining infringement. First, a quick overview. Title 35 of the United States Code codifies our patent laws for obtaining patents, utility, and design. Enforcing that patent through the traditional avenue means going to court and challenging the validity of a patent either during traditional litigation or going to the Patent and Trademark Office, the agency that issued the patent, and seeking invalidity proceedings in post-grant proceedings there. Section 171 of Title 35 authorizes an inventor to obtain a patent for any new, original, and ornamental design for an article of infringement subject to the conditions and requirements of this title. The subject to language of this provision implies that other patentability requirements not specified here also apply. In particular, the same patentability requirements that relate to utility patents, and importantly, the requirement that a design must not be obvious, are all in play. So the central elements of design patentability in the United States are, first, novelty, second, originality, third, ornamentality, meaning the design's ornamental appearance is not dictated by function alone, fourth, the subject matter must be for an article of manufacture, and fifth, the design must be non-obvious. I'm going to talk about some of these elements here, answering some of the questions that the conference organizers kindly provided to us. There are other requirements to obtaining a design patent, but they relate more to the manner in which the design patent is applied for as opposed to the design itself, and I'm going to limit my discussion to the patentability requirements applied to the design itself.
예, 충실한 답변 감사드리고요.
Thank you very much.
지금부터는
for your answer.
디자인의 물품성에 관련된 질문을 패널분들께 드리겠습니다. 첫 번째 질문은 디자인의 성립 요건으로 물품성을 요구하는지 그리고 완성품이 아닌 부품에 대해서도 디자인이 등록될 수 있는지 여부에 대한 질문입니다. 이 질문에 대한 답변은 먼저 정택수 부장판사님부터 답변해 주시기 바랍니다.
Would you please start answering the question?
Yes,
thank you. Regarding the requirement related to the the provision that it must be expressed on an article. Article means a tangible and transportable object. And it is also a combination of various color and shape and so on. Here, article is an independent object. And these requirements need to be met so that it can be registered as a design. And it also needs to meet the industrial application requirements, which means the possibility for mass production of items with that. It should be independent trading object. And as for component or part, it needs to have substitutability.
And
actually, it's not to say that there must be actual trading of the component in the marketplace and substituted by other articles, but merely the possibility of independent training and substitutability shall suffice. And in this example you see here, it didn't meet the requirements related to the article of manufacture. This is a very important aspect. It needs to be able to be implemented in a certain consistent shape. In this case, the patent court mentioned that it's not always possible to produce this item in the exact same shape, but it can be repeatedly produced in a form that can be recognized as identical to the shape claimed as the scope of protection in the design at issue. So if it's a form with a level of identity that can be seen as the same item from a reasonable point of view.
예, 다음은 미국의 조던 판사님의 답변을 듣겠습니다.
Let's listen to the answer from Mr. Jordan.
So for design to be patentable, the design must be for an article of manufacture. Since the enactment of the design patent statute, the United States only permits patent and protection for designs that either compromise the article of manufacture itself or that form a permanent part of the underlying article fixed within or worked onto its physical structure. This was originally identified as the fixation requirement. Thus, a standalone design or picture would not be protectable because it is a design in the abstract completely separate from a physical structure. The physical fixation requirement led early courts to invalidate patents for designs that were connected to but divisible from the article itself. For example, in the 1800s, a court invalidated a design patent for a card upon which pearl buttons were presented to consumers. They explained, the court did, that the buttons are to be used by the purchaser, but the card is not. The design does not apply to the manufacturer proper, but only to the arrangement of it for sale. And putting an article into a more conventional form for sale without changing its qualities or properties is not patentable as an improvement in the article. That's a quote from the court. And you could take some issue with, you know, talking about the improvement in the article, but that was the language, and the idea was that the express fixation requirement hadn't been met there. That requirement, that express fixation requirement, was abandoned in 1902 when the act was changed so that the design patentability statute could be simplified. And the requirement was replaced with the article of manufacture language we're familiar with today. But contemporary courts continued then, and modern courts continue now, to interpret Section 171 to include some sort of fixation requirement through its interpretation of the article of manufacture language, although with less bright line rules than perhaps existed before. Nevertheless, courts have recognized a relatively broad scope of eligibility for patent protections for designs that demonstrate a permanent relationship with the article itself. Naturally, before we can determine whether a design is for an article of manufacture, We must determine whether the object embodying the design is indeed an article of manufacture. There was substantial less uncertainty as to what constituted an article of manufacture in the early cases because manufactured objects consisted pretty well exclusively of tangible human-made items. But how that term is defined today has evolved somewhat as we've moved further away from the traditional physical human-made structures to the protectability of some designs produced in the digital age. Still, though the breadth of the term article manufacture continues to evolve, it remains mostly rooted in early cases. For example, in 1913, my court, the United States Court of Appeals for the Third Circuit, held that a roof structure qualifies as an article of manufacture and said that the word manufacture has often been classified as a term of art in tariff, commercial, and bankruptcy cases. Manufacture was understood to mean a transformation or the fashioning of raw materials into a change of form for use. The Supreme Court has explained that the primary meaning of the word manufacture is something made by hand as distinguished from natural growth, but as machinery is something that is largely supplanted, the primitive method of, you know, hand making things by hand, the word has been used to denote any article upon which the material of the article itself has had some labor imbued and expended to finish the product. So the term manufacturer has been defined broadly to include objects where humans contribute to the transformation of the raw materials into an article having a utilitarian purpose.
예, 말씀 잘 들었고요. 이어서 일본에서 보내주신 스루오카 판사님의 답변을 듣겠습니다.
Listen to the answer from Judge Suruoka from Japan through the video clip.
それでは第1問について回答します。日本では衣装法2条1項が衣装の定義をしています。それによれば、衣装には次の3つのものが生まれます。第1は物品、部品を含むですけれども、の形状、模様、もしくは色彩、もしくはこれらの結合です。第2は建築物、建築物の部品を含みますが、これの形状などです。第3は画像です。画像は機器の操作のように供されるもの、または機器がその機能を発揮した結果として表示されるものに限られます。建築物と画像は2019年の法改正によって衣装権の保護の対象に含められました。なお物品とは一般に有体物である動産を指し独立して取引の対象となるものを言います。次に完成品の一部に衣装を登録することができるかですけれども、これは可能です。部品も互換性を有し、通常の状態で独立した取引の対象になっていれば物品に当たるので衣装登録の対象となります。また日本では物品には物品の部分を含むというふうにされていますから、いわゆる部分衣装も認められています。部分衣装における部分の要件は当該物品全体の形態の中で一定の範囲を占める部分であり、当該物品において他の衣装と対比する際に対比の対象となり得る部分というふうにされています。以上です。
예끝으로멀리영국에서준비하고계시는빌 변호사님
ask Mr. Bill from the UK,
답변부탁드리겠습니다
Please answer the question.
Thank you for the question. A very interesting question because the approach in the European Union and the UK is so different. Now, I hope that in a moment I'm going to be able to share my screen with you so that I can show you some images. But let me give you an overall picture of the situation. In the UK and in EU harmonized law, there is no bright line requirement for a design to be expressed on an article. there is a much looser requirement because of the very broad definition of product, which in practice encompasses articles and less tangible expressions of design. That is because the concept of design is defined as the appearance of the whole or the part of an article, of a product, resulting from the features of, in particular, the lines, contours, shape, texture, and or materials of the product itself or its ornamentation. And the product is itself very widely defined as meaning any industrial or handicraft item, including, amongst other things, parts intended to be assembled into a complex product, packaging, get-up, graphic symbols, and typographical typefaces. So, given that the definition of design encompasses not only products, but the appearance of products, but also the appearance of ornamentation, and the product itself can include get-up and graphic symbols, the limitation to expressed on an article is no longer part of our design law. So what I would like to do is to share you some images by way of example. Shown here is a page of examples of design from the European Union's Intellectual Property Office. And you see it includes logos, computer icons, the get-up of shop interiors, as well as plain ornamentation and parts of products and composite products and so on. So that leads me to the kind of example that I've included in my paper, for instance, BAW London Limited's RCD, where 10 plain text designs using a mixture of bold and phonetic symbols and italics and smaller scripts, such as this one, the definition of, or a fake definition of warrior, were held to be registrable. Equally, and perhaps strikingly, in the Team Lava and King.com case, the registrations were identified as being for animated icons. And these icons that looked like sweets were then to appear in video games, and a single object was to take these three different appearances. But that does not mean there is no limit on the range of designs that can be registered. And for example, in the example I've shown you here, ACJ Amelun, the need for the design to be the design of a product which is an industrial or handicraft item meant that a tomato that had been bred to be heart-shaped could not be registered as a design because it wasn't an industrial or handicraft item.
예, 아주 멀리서 답변해 주셨지만 바로 이 자리에 있는 것처럼 생생하고 친절하게 답변해 주셔서 감사합니다. 마치기 전에 그 조던 판사님께서 제조 물품성의 용어의 범위를 보여주는 미국의 사례를 소개해 주시겠습니다. 동영상 답변으로 다 같이 한번 확인해 보도록 하겠습니다.
One interesting example that demonstrates the breadth of the term article of manufacture today is in Ray Hruby, a case that dates back now more than 50 years. It's a 1967 case from the Court of Customs and Patent Appeals. In that case, that court reversed the Patent Board's decision to reject design patent protection for water fountain. The question before the board and the court was whether that portion of a water fountain that is composed entirely of water in motion is within the statutory term of article of manufacture. The court first noted that the shape created in a specific fountain is manufactured by man in the sense that water as a raw material is put into planned patterns of motion for accomplishment of a decorative purpose. So the water in motion met the human-made requirement for an article of manufacture. The central question on appeal in the case, however, was directed at another underlying requirement for an article of manufacture, namely the permanency requirement. As I previously mentioned, courts look for some sort of permanent relationship between the design and the article of manufacture. Consequently, the article of manufacture itself must meet the permanency requirement. In In re Hruby, the patent office had denied a design patent application for the water fountain because the portion of the fountain, which is composed entirely of water in motion, was seen to be a wholly fleeting product and therefore couldn't meet the permanency requirement necessary to be an article of manufacture. The Court of Custom and Patent Appeals disagreed, rejecting the patent office's classification of the water in motion as fleeting. The court explained that the permanence of any design is a function of the materials in which it is embodied and the effects of the environment thereon. The ornamental shape of the fountain could, the court said, remain substantially constant and will at such times present an overall appearance virtually the same from day to day if certain parameters are maintained. While the patent application did not disclose the particular means for producing the fountain, in fact, the court took notice that it is recognized that maintenance of parameters such as orifice configuration, water pressure, and freedom from disturbing atmospheric conditions would result in a permanent visual appearance of the water fountain sufficient to constitute an article of manufacture. In addition, the court reminded us that we look at the product as a whole when determining whether it is an article of manufacture. While it is true, the court said, that a particular droplet or droplets of water may be a fleeting product, the same cannot be said of the fountain itself. The fountain in its entirety, under proper conditions, presented a product of a constant appearance rather than a fleeting product. The court's holding protecting the apparent visual shape of the streams of a water fountain as a proper design patent subject matter is indicative of the United States' liberal interpretation of its Section 171. And that broad construction has further resulted in the application of this law to designs that are embodied on a part of a product so long as the design meets the same design patentability requirements previously discussed. To sum it up, the design must be embodied on or applied to an article of manufacture, but the design need not be for the article as opposed to a portion of the article to be patentable. A design is not protectable in the abstract or if it is divisible from the article of manufacture. And the article of manufacture itself must be a human-made, or at least there must be a human contribution to that tangible product, and that the product remains substantially constant or permanent. And that's the end of my contribution on question one.
Yeah. Yeah, 이어서 다음은 불법성이 관한 두 번째로 글자체 디자인에 관한 질문을 드리겠습니다. 질문 내용은 글자체에 대한 디자인이 등록될 수 있는지와 그 유사성 판단 기준에 대해서 질문 드리겠습니다. 먼저 영국의 빌 변호사님 답변 부탁드리겠습니다.
Listen to the answer from Mr. Bill from the UK first.
Thank you for the question. The answer straightforward. Yes, typefaces can be registered. The answer is found in the legislation, so that's Article 3 of the EU Designs Regulation, which provides the community-wide design registration structure, and in Article 1 of the Designs Directive, which provides the standard by which national laws must protect registered designs, and that approach is going to continue in the UK after the UK has left the European Union. The reason that typefaces can be protected is because of the definition of design as meaning the appearance of the whole or a part of a product, In particular, the lines, contours, shapes, textures of the product itself or its industrial or handicraft item, including typographical typefaces. Now, that being the case, the test for whether a typeface can be registered is the same as for any other registered design. The question is whether the typeface has individual character. Now, you might ask the question, well, isn't that a bit of an anomaly? Because a typeface is really not very much of a handicraft item. Well, part of the answer for that lies in history, because of course typefaces were handicraft items, because the creation of a typeface involved making individual pieces of type, which could then be used in a printing press. Now in the modern context, there is a great similarity, of course, between typefaces and icons and other graphic elements that are created in computer systems, which our new liberal approach encompasses. There are very few cases on typefaces in the UK. You can see, for instance, Microsoft Corporation's design about a typeface which was almost identical to a Linotype typeface and not allowed to be registered. And there are also examples of partial typefaces that could be registered instead as a set of characters.
예, 감사합니다. 예, 다음은 중국의 축지영 변호사님.
Thank you very much. 예, We'd like to listen from
중국에서는 글자체는 디자인 보호 객체가
아니기
때문에
China, 디자인에 의하여
보호할 수 없습니다.
Cannot be registered as a
design.
Regarding calligraphy, has the aesthetic value. So in China, typeface is regarded as an object of art. It's not subject to patent.
중국에서 등록될 수 없기 때문에
So typeface cannot be registered as a design in China. So that's all I can say
예,
from
예,
China's
감사합니다.
perspectives.
그러면 이어서
Thank you very much.
마지막 답변인데요. 미국의 조던 판사님의 답변을 듣겠습니다.
For his answer.
Hi, now I'm going to answer question 2 in session 3, still dealing with articles of manufacture. This one being posed by our organizers as whether a typeface can be registered as a design in your country, and if so, what is the legal basis for that? What are the standards to determine similarity of typeface designs in your country? The answer is yes. Typeface or type font is protectable under United States design patent laws. In fact, the very first United States design patent issued in 1842 covered a typeface designed by a gentleman named George Bruce. And the United States Patent and Trademark Office published a shout out to Mr. Bruce on Twitter for his design 175 years after issuance. Typeface, according to a House report from the US House of Representatives dealing with this issue back in 1976, is defined as a set of letters, numbers, or other symbolic characters whose forms are related by repeating design elements consistently applied in a notational system and are intended to be embodied in articles whose intrinsic utilitarian function is for composing text or other cognizable combinations of characters. Which is a very long and fancy way of saying you can write with it, you can communicate ideas with it. Design patents can offer broad protection for typeface, protecting any ornamental characteristics of a set of letters or other characters beyond their utilitarian function, that is, their function being to convey language. Design patents for typeface must meet the same patentability requirements as any other protectable design. Notably, though, design patent protection for typeface has contributed to some of the shift in how the United States defines what an article of manufacture is. As I previously discussed, design patents only apply to articles of manufacture, meaning physical products that were created by people. in the late 19th century, when typeface design pads were more often utilized, the typeface was cast in metal or carved from some other material, making it easy to identify the physical article of manufacture. But nowadays, typefaces are often digital and applied through some computer program. Nevertheless, typeface applied through computer programs can still overcome the requisite hurdle for being an article of manufacture. In fact, while the United States Patent and Trademark Office originally rejected electronic designs for failure to meet the article of manufacture requirement, it reversed that position in 1996, and specifically, the Patent and Trademark Office issued guidelines clarifying that while type fonts have traditionally been generated by solid blocks from which each letter or symbol was produced, type fonts do not fail to comply with the article of manufacture requirement on the basis that more modern methods of typesetting, including computer generation, do not require solid printed blocks. And after seeking public comment on its guidelines for examination of design patent applications for computer-generated icons, the USPTO determined that a design for a computer-generated icon which is embodied in an actual article of manufacture is statutory subject matter for a design patent under Section 171.
예. 다음은 물품 수행에 관련된 마지막 질문인데요. 화상 디자인에 관한 것입니다. 화상 디자인에 대해서는 각국의 입법례가 차이가 있는 것 같은데요. 관련해서 화상 디자인이 디자인으로 등록될 수 있는지, 그리고 등록이 가능하다면 그 요건으로 물품 수행을 요구하는지 여부에 대해서 답변을 듣도록 하겠습니다. 먼저 일본의 스루카 판사님의 답변을 듣겠습니다.
First, we'd like to listen to Judge Throka from Japan.
この質問は CG 画像を画像そのものとして意匠登録できるかどうかという意味であるとご理解して回答をいたします。日本では画像は機器の操作のように供されるもの、または機器がその機能を発揮した結果として表示されるものに限り意匠として登録することが可能です。意匠法2条1項に操作が定められています。前者はパソコン画面に表示されるアイコンなどであり、後者はデジタル時計の画面に表示される時刻表示などです。これに対し、壁紙などの装飾的な画像や映画、ゲームなどのコンテンツ画像などは、上記の要件には当てはまらず、意匠としての登録はできないとされています。したがって、CG 画像を意匠登録できるかどうかは、このいずれの類型に当たるかによって判断をされることになります。今申しました通り、画像は一定の場合には画像それ自体として意匠登録することができ、その場合には画像が物品上に表現される必要はありません。例えばデジタル時計の表示画面を部屋の壁に投影する場合、画像が物品上に表現されているとは言えないだろうと思いますけれども、意匠としての登録は可能だということになります。以上です。
예이어서중국의축지영변호사님의 예답변을 듣겠습니다.
From 축지영 attorney from China. In China, simple computer generated graphic content cannot apply for a design patent. Patent, but it should be expressed on an article. Computer-based graphic design should be expressed on an article in China. According to the relevant regulation in China, a product design patent application for a graphic user interface, it should explain the purpose of graphic user interface and the area of the GUI in the product in the way of human-computer interaction and the state of change. GUI refers to the graphical display of a computer-oriented user interface. GUI is an interface enabling people to communicate with computers. It allows users to use an input device such as a mouse to manipulate icons or menu options on the screen, so that they can select commands, invoke files, or perform other daily tasks. If you look at the picture below, GUI can be registered as a design only when it is expressed on the electronic watch. Thank you.
예, 감사합니다.
Thank you for your answer.
끝으로 영국의 빌 변호사님 예, 답변 부탁합니다.
Mr. Bill for your answer.
The answer in relation to graphical user interfaces in UK and European law is that yes, they can be registered. The reason is again because of the broad definition of design, which covers the appearance of the whole or a part of a product, including its ornamentation, and the wide definition of product, meaning any industrial or handicraft item, including graphic symbols, so that a practice has developed of allowing registration of icons, as I illustrated in my first item, and logos, and parts of the displays in computer systems. So, for example, the logo case that I showed you before, the Team Lava case, about the three-dimensional suite-like icons, gives you an example. And so it's possible to obtain registrations for parts of interfaces which are graphic user interfaces. In fact, that used to be the case under the old UK law, which was more restrictive. That result was reached by reasoning that the graphic user interface was a feature of the product which that interface formed part of. The requirement, therefore, that the graphic user interface needs to express on an article has effectively been removed by the wide definition of design in European and UK design law.
예, 감사합니다. 예, 그럼 다음으로는 두 번째 주자인
Next, I'd like
주제인,
to ask,
주제인의 유사에 대해 논의해 보도록 하겠습니다.
Talk about the next topic, the
먼저
similarity of design.
주제인 유사 여부에서 그 주체를 누구로 하여 판단하는지에 대해서 설명을 부탁드리도록 하겠습니다. 먼저 한국의 권순민 부장판사님의 답변부터 듣겠습니다.
네, 답변할 수 있는 기회를 주셔서 감사합니다.
Thank you for the opportunity to answer the question.
디자인 유사 판단의 주체에 관해서는
In regard to the criteria for determining similarities of designs, there are countries such as Japan that codify the criteria. But Korean Design Protection Act doesn't specify criteria which creates problems in practices. The problem is closely related to criteria of design similarities. According to the theory of creation, since the determination is made by identifying a relationship between creative content of a design and form of design, determination is made based on an average designer. However, according to the other theories, such as theory of aesthetics and the theory of confusion, determination is made based solely on the form of a design and thus is based on the general consumer. The Supreme Court of Korea held that similarity should be judged based on whether the overall observation of elements consisting of a design, such as a shape, pattern, or color. Here, it is not clearly defined whether the viewers refer to a general consumer or an average designer in the field of design. However, it is generally understood that judicial precedents adopt a general consumer as a standard from the perspective of the theory of aesthetics. This can be seen in the judicial precedent, which uses the term general consumer concerning the human standard for determining similarity of designs. And if you look at some precedent or precedents that aesthetic sense from the appearance, not only when an article is on which the design is expressed is used, but also when the article is traded. The term general consumers have been widely used in trademarks as well. The Supreme Court said in decision of trademark similarities, general consumers include final consumers as well as intermediate consumers or wholesalers and retailers, which means inclusion of traders who have expertise. Based on the decision, it is possible different scope and definition of general consumers can be set depending on specific situations.
예, 감사합니다. 예, 다음은 미국의 조던 판사님 답변 들어보겠습니다.
Turning to the questions associated with the topic similarity of designs, I'm going to answer questions 4 and 5 very briefly. Question 4 here in session 3 asks, please describe whose perspective is considered to determine design similarity in your country. Please give an outline of any related judicial precedents that have been debated in your country. Question 5, in your country, when determining similarity of designs, is it required that the articles in question be identical or similar? If so, what are the standards by which identity or similarity is determined? And some related questions. I'm not going to answer all of those sub-questions, but I am going to tell you that design similarity is the focus when determining whether a design patent has been infringed, as well as when determining whether a patentable design is new, either when applying for a design patent or when asserting that a patent is invalid for lack of novelty. The question of design similarity uses the same test for analysis when in any of those questions, that is when there's an infringement claim, when you're seeking the patent, design patent to begin with, or when you're being challenged for invalidity. In all instances, the test is the average or ordinary observer test. That test originates from the Supreme Court seminal decision in Gorham Company versus White from 1871, which provides that if in the eye of an ordinary observer giving such attention as a purchaser usually gives, two designs are substantially the same, if the resemblance is such as to deceive such an observer, inducing him to purchase one, supposing it to be the other, the first one patented is infringed by the other. So, let me try to give you a quick summary of that. If an ordinary observer using the ordinary level of attention they give when looking at products, looks at two designs, and is deceived because of their similarity and induced to purchase one, supposing it to be the other, there's an infringement. The ordinary observer test applies to the patented design in its entirety, as it is claimed. Courts presume that the ordinary observer is familiar with the prior art designs and reviews, the differences between the claimed and accused designs in light of the prior art. If the claimed design is close to the prior art designs, small differences between the accused design and the claimed design assume more importance to the eye of the hypothetical ordinary observer. Under this standard, in infringement cases, courts must first identify the ordinary observer and then the fact finder, sometimes a court, sometimes the jury in the United States, steps into the shoes of that observer and considers the designs of the patented product and the asserted product side by side. In its comparison, the fact finder must analyze the design as a whole. It cannot adopt a piecemeal approach or first consider whether each design element independently affects the overall visual impression that the designs are similar. Rather, the court finds infringement of a design patent when an ordinary observer is deceived by the asserted design as a result of similarities in the overall design, not of similarities in ornamental features considered in isolation. So that's the test. That's how it's supposed to be applied. Those are the questions I chose to answer. Thanks again for letting me participate in session 3.
예. 이어서 영국의 빌 변호사님, 예, 답변 부탁드리겠습니다.
Thank you, Mr. Bill
from the UK. Thank you for the question. Now, I'm going to concentrate on the question of from whose perspective the question of design similarity is assessed in the UK and EU design courts, because the following questions are going to deal with similarity in article and similarity so far as the standard and approach that is adopted. So starting off with from whose perspective, the answer is defined in our law as being from the perspective of an informed user, and it's from their perspective that the question of whether a design is new and whether the design has individual character is tested, and from which the question of infringement is tested, and both the question of validity and infringement, of individual character and infringement, are tested by reference to the overall impression produced by the design on an informed user, taking into account the existing design corpus and the degree of freedom of the designer in developing the design. All of that is set out in the legislation, in the regulation and the directive, which mirror one another. There is case law that addresses the characteristics of the informed user, and one of the most important cases is the European Court of Justice's judgment in PepsiCo and Grupo Proma, which was about a case about promotional discs that were distributed as toys for children, effectively. And that definition of the informed user identifies them as a person who is understood as lying somewhere between the average consumer applicable in trademark matters and the sectoral expert applicable to patents. So this person who is in between those two is an expert with detailed is not an expert with detailed technical expertise as in patent matters, but is somebody who is a user of average attention, but a particularly observant one, either because of his personal experience or his extensive knowledge of the sector. And the details of such a person were explained by the English Court of Appeal in the famous case of Samsung and Apple, in which the iPad design was held to be not infringed by Samsung's tablet design because, amongst other things, the Apple design was cool. The features of the the informed user were listed as seven, including that he or she is a user of the product, is particularly observant, has knowledge of the design corpus, is interested in the products concerned, conducts a direct comparison of the products if he or she can, unless there are specific circumstances in the market that mean that that's not practicable. For instance, street lamps, which sit in different places around the city. And the informed user is neither merely perceives the design as a whole and does not analyze it in detail, nor observes minimal differences. So it provides a middle ground of observance of features of designs by which the court can apply its tests for validity and infringement.
예, 예, 감사합니다. 끝으로 중국의 축지영 변호사님 답변입니다.
We'd like to listen from
디자인 요사 여부 판단에 있어서
In China, we refer to the ordinary consumer's knowledge level and cognitive ability as the judgment criteria. Regarding the interpretation of the Supreme People's Court concerning certain issues on the application of law for the trial of cases on disputes over infringement on patent rights, he says that the knowledge level and cognitive ability of ordinary consumers of the products of patented design should be the criteria to determine whether industrial design is the same or similar. So the examiner judges whether the design patent applications are clearly inconsistent with paragraph 1, article 23 of the patent law. And according to Beijing Higher People's Court for Patent Infringement Judge Guide, whether the design is same or similar, the overall visual effect of the judging ability and knowledge of ordinary consumers should be taken as the standard. And ordinary consumers refer to people who have knowledge and cognitive ability, and they determine whether the design of the registered item is similar or not with the applied design.
예, 감사합니다.
Thank you.
다음 질문은 디자인 유사 여부 판단에서 디자인의 대상 물품이 동일 유사할 것을 요구하고 있는지 그리고 그 판단 기준은 무엇인지에 대한 것에서 질문을 드리겠습니다. 먼저 영국의 빌 변호사님 답변 부탁드리겠습니다.
Mr. Bill.
In short, the answer is no. It is not required by UK or EU design law that the articles in question must be identical or similar. The reason is because the registered design has an existence of its own. So although the design means the appearance of the whole or a part of a product, it has that wide definition including industrial and handicraft items extending to graphic symbols. More specifically in the regulation that creates community registered designs, there's an article that requires the application to contain an indication of the product on which the design is intended to be incorporated or to which it is intended to be applied. That's Article 36.2 of the regulation. But its effect is circumscribed by Article 36.6, which provides that this shall not affect the scope of protection of the design as such. And for infringement, the alleged infringement must just create on the informed user something which must create on the informed user the same overall impression, or in other words, it does not create on the informed user a different overall impression. The effect of this has been explained, for instance, in the English Court of Appeal by Lord Justice Jacob in Green Lane Products and PMS International, where he explained that if you register a design for a car, you can stop the use of that design for a brooch, or a cake, or a toy. And if you register a textile design, you can stop its use on wallpaper, or a shirt, or a plate. Nor does it matter what size the alleged infringing design is, compared to the product for which the design was registered. That approach has most recently been confirmed by the Court of Appeal in the Crown ex parte British American Tobacco against the Secretary of State for Health, the case about whether restrictions on tobacco advertising somehow took away people's property rights in the IP, which protected their tobacco brands.
예, 감사합니다. 다음은 한국의 권순민 부장판사님의 답변을 듣겠습니다.
Next, Mr. 권순민.
네, 디자인 유사 판단에 있어서 물품이 동일 유사할 것을 요구하는지에 관한 논의는
When deciding similarities of design, is it required that the article in question to be identical or similarity? To answer the question, I can say that this question is closely related to discussion of the first question. As Article 2.1 of the Design Protection Act stipulates, Korean design systems believe there is an inseparability between design and articles. Since the design cannot exist away from an article, two different articles are considered different articles even if they have similar appearance. And it can have difference from the practices in Europe. Furthermore, the Supreme Court has understood that it has lit-tackle picture, and the Supreme Court said there is a difference in the
다음으로 the train and the pipe. 용도와 기능을 들고 있습니다.
As a criteria of similarities, the Supreme Court looked at the purpose of use of an article and the action or function of an article, because the purpose of use of an article and the action of function, which can realize them, the essence of the article and the fundamental reasons for the article to exist. But the Supreme Court take the position of having the use and function of an article as a principle. And here the examples are mayonnaise container and glue container. They are two different articles, but both of them are containers holding articles close to liquid. Furthermore, the Supreme Court has understood that it has broad view about identity and similarities of articles. In other words, even if the articles are different in terms of their use and function, the articles should be viewed as a similar articles. And decision showed that there is a difference in the bubble overflow prevention device, the subject article is sold to be used for boiling laundry on top right on the screen, and the circulation tube on the bottom right. But they are similar in shape, and in terms of their function is substantially the same, and that it keeps the bubbles or the rice water generated from the inside of the container from overflowing. So they are the same.
축지영, the attorney from China.
디자인의 유사 여부 판단에 있어서 물품이 동일 유사한 것을 요구하고 있습니다. 중국 최고 이민법원의 특허권 침해 등 사건 등에 관한 법률 적용 관련 해석 제8조에 따르면 디자인 특허 제품과 동일하거나 비슷한 종류의 제품에 대해 등록 디자인과 동일하거나 유사한 디자인을 하는 경우 이민법원은 권리침해로 피소된 디자인이 특허법 제52조 제2항을 규정해 디자인 특허권의 보호 범위에 속한 것을 인정해야 한다고 규정했습니다. 관련 판단 기준에 대하여는 중국 최고 이민법원의 특허권 침해 분쟁 사건 심리에 관한 법률 적용 관련 해석 제9조에 따르면 이민법원은 디자인 물품의 용도에 따라 물품의 종류가 동일하거나 유사한지 여부를 판단해야 합니다. 물품의 용도를 확인하려면 디자인의 간략한 설명, 디자인 종류표,
For this, we refer to international design classification, specification, and other information. Thank you.
예, 감사합니다.
Thank you for your
그럼 이어서 디자인
Then
유사 세 번째 소지인데요. 등록
topic.
디자인의 일부분에 공지된 형상 또는 주제의 형상이 포함되어 있는 경우에 등록 요건을 판단할 때와 권리 범위를 판단할 때 그 중요도를 동일하게 보는지에 대한 질문을 드리도록 하겠습니다. 이에 대해서는 먼저 한국의 권수민 부장판사님의 질문 답변부터 듣도록 하겠습니다.
예, 한국 대법원은
The Supreme Court of Korea applies different standards when deciding design similarity and registrability determination and the scope of rights determination when a registered design partially contains a publicly known shape.
먼저 등록 여건 판단 시에는
When determining registerability, such as protection and invalidation, where part of a registered design contains a shape that is publicly known, the publicly known shape should not be excluded unless it is not an element which invokes specific aesthetic sense. This is understood because in determining novelty of a design, if the publicly known part that is common in the filed design and the compared design is excluded from the prominent part, a contradiction may occur where novelty of the filed design, including the publicly known part, has easily recognized than registered. On the other hand, it is the position of the judicial precedent that when deciding similarity in the scope of rights or infringement, a publicly known part should be considered as less important. As you can see on the screen, the work uniform on the top right, top half is a dark color and the bottom half is bright color. It's already publicly known, as you can see in the picture.
For this reason, 그런되고 있습니다. 이러한 입장은 창작설에 가까운
것으로 But it seems reasonable to consider the publicly known part less important instead of completely excluding it from components of a design.
공지 부분을 디자인의 구성 요소에서 아예 제외하는 것이 아니라 공지 부분의
Instead of completely excluding the design from components of a design and simply by excluding it from the prominent part when determining scope of a rights, we can more reasonably deal with the public known part. When determining registerability and the scope of a right, it is ideal to have consistent interpretation.
디자인의 창작상 특징이 어디에 있는지 고려하는 것은
당연합니다. From this perspective of fairness of a right generated through administrative procedures and quality and profits of a third party from a right with practical flaws, it is more practical that validity of a right should remain and its effectiveness should be limited. Next, it seems that the Supreme Court doesn't handle a case with a well-known shape differently from a case with a publicly known shape. As the definition indicates, it is likely that such a well-known form is often not be viewed by consumers with attention in a specific transaction situation. From this perspective, the Supreme Court held if a design adopts a generally common and well-known shape, it cannot become the prominent part. But in a later decision of an invalidation case, the court said even if a shape is well known, it may not be said that the part fails to invoke ornamental aesthetic sense. In the court also held the similarity of a design should be determined based on the ornamental aesthetic sense. The bottom right is the prior design and the bottom left is the registered design. The design is described as beehive shape. So the attitude of this recent judgment seemed to presume that well known.
다음에 이어서 일본의 스루오카 판사님 답변 듣겠습니다.
Mr. Suruoka from Japan.
第6 問について 回答します。 登録可能性の決定と権利の範囲の決定では適用される基準が異なります。まず登録可能性の決定における類似の判断ですが、これは次のように行われます。まず登録が求められている衣装とそれと対比すべき衣装の形態を認定します。次に両衣装を対比し共通点と 採点、違う点を認定します。さらに共通点及び採点について需要者の注意を引く部分か、遺憾に与える影響が大きいかを判断します。最後に全体的観察において衣装全体として共通の遺憾をもたらすかどうかを判断します。この判断の中で高知の形状を除外し 除外して考える必要はないという見解が多数の見解です。それは、先に申しましたような判断をした結果、高知衣装と類似であると認められるのであれば、新規性は否定される時なのであって、その場合に、その高知衣装をさらにそれ以前の高知衣装と比較して、
類似性を持たせているのは高地の形状部分なのか、それ以外の部分なのかを分析して考える必要はないからです。これに対して信頼かどうかを決定する際の類似の判断は次のように行われます。まず登録衣装と被疑信頼衣装の形態の認定をします。次に衣装の囲碁部を認定します。最後に囲碁が共通か異なる美観が生じるかを判断します。そして囲碁の認定においては、 高地の形状ではない新規の創作部分があるかどうかという点が考慮されます。つまり高地の形状というのは養分の認定において重要なものとは考えられていないということになります。これは高地の形状に過ぎないものが登録衣装の権利範囲に取り込まれてしまうことを防止するためだというふうに言えると思います。 以上の点に関して高地の形状と周知の形状とで取り扱いに違いはないと思われます。最後に関連する裁判例を紹介します。登録可能性の決定における高地の形状の3尺に関しては、例えば知財高裁2007年9月10日判決があり、次の通り判断しています。 衣装法3条1項3号該当性における高地衣装と出願にかかる衣装との類比を判断するにあたっては、高地衣装についてさらに以前から存在した高地衣装との比較をした上で養護を認定することは合理性がなく、単に両者の共通点、採点を総合して類比判断すべきである、このように判断しています。 次に権利範囲の決定に関しては、東京地裁2008年2月19日判決などがあり、次のように判断しています。衣装の類比を判断するにあたっては、衣装にかかる物品の性質、用途、使用対応、さらには高地衣装にない新規な創作部分の損費などを参酌して、衣装にかかる物品について、 重要者の注意を引きつけるを衣装の用具として把握し、両衣装が用具において構成対応が共通するかどうかを注視するに観察をして、両衣装が全体として罹患を共通するか否かを判断すべきである、このように判断をしています。以上です。
예, 잘 들었습니다. 야, 끝으로 영국의 빌 변호사님 답변 부탁드리겠습니다.
감사합니다. And so how that affects the standards applicable to registrability can be answered in short by explaining that publicly known shapes and well-known shapes end up being treated differently because of the test for validity. Now, a design can be valid if it is new and has individual character. A design is new if no identical design has been made available to the public before the date of the filing of the application or its priority date. And designs are deemed to be identical if their features differ only in immaterial details. And the design is considered to have individual character if the overall impression it produces on the informed user differs from the overall impression produced on such a user by any design which has been made available to the public before the date of filing or the priority date of the design. So the test is a one of individual character, which depends upon the overall impression produced by a design on an informed user compared to individual designs that have come before. And in carrying out that assessment, the informed user takes into account the degree of freedom of the designer and their knowledge of the design corpus in general, but they do not get to combine features from individual designs in carrying out that analysis. And that was determined by the European Court of Justice in a case called Karen Millen. So that when one comes to the kind of question that this question asks, the process of comparison, which was explained by the UK Supreme Court in Magmatic and PMS, the case about trunky children's ride-on suitcases, brings the question into focus. The English Court of Appeal explained in that case that the most important things in a case about registered designs are the registered design, firstly, secondly, the accused object, and thirdly, the prior art. And the most important thing about each of those is what they look like. But what is required to assess validity and individual character is a global assessment which requires consideration of the visual impression created by the registered design and the accused design. The informed user will, however, attach less significance to features which form part of the design corpus and therefore are design features that are well known. The effect is therefore that a comparison between an individual piece of prior art is carried out to see whether the new design creates a different overall impression. And it's only features which are well-known shapes, in the definition of the question, which would form part of the design corpus and therefore have lesser visual significance to the informed user when carrying out that comparison.
예, 예, 감사합니다. 이제 저희 세션의 마지막 주제, 세 번째 주제인데요.
Now let's move on to the last topic of the session.
열기가 되다 보니까 저희 현재인 시간이 가까워지는데 패널분들께서 열기 때문에 조금 시간이 오버되는 것 같습니다.
But it seems like we are a little behind our schedule.
정리한 시간을 맞춰주시고 동영상 답변자들이 제 시간을 잘 지켜주시는데
여러분들도
말씀드린 시간을 잘 맞추시면 좋겠습니다. 마지막으로 세 번째 주제는 디자인의 창작 비용성에 대한 것입니다.
The third topic is about the design that is
Design의 창작 비용성을 디자인 금용 조건으로 하고 있는지 그리고 그 판단 기준은 무엇인지에 대해서 질문을 드리도록 하겠습니다. 방금 전에 답변하셨던 빌 변호사님 다시 한번 답변 부탁드리겠습니다.
Mr. Bill, would you please answer?
As I said in my written answers, the short answer to this question is no. It's not the difficulty or ease of creation of a design that determines whether a design is registrable in the UK or the EU. But one has to bear in mind that the test is the question of individual character of the new design as compared by an informed user. And therefore, the difference is difference in visual impact. The result is, therefore, that difference is required from pre-existing designs rather than questioning the design input of the designer. And the reason for that is because the legislation tries to create a mirror balance between the test for infringement, whether something does not create on an informed user a different overall impression, and the test for validity.
Yeah, yeah, 감사합니다. 그러면 이어서 한국의 정택수 부장판사님의 답변을 듣겠습니다.
정택수 for the answer.
네, 감사합니다.
Thank you very much. Before I answer the question, I'd like to say that the judge Bill from UK, thank you very much for your insight. I respect you really a lot. And your answer will give us a lot of insight for further advancing our study on this area. Our Design Protection Act says that a design may not be registered if it can be easily created by an ordinary designer. And through various precedences, we say that the assessment of level of creativity is the purpose of Design Protection Act. So if we refer to the cases precedents from Supreme Court decisions, first, design imitating or appropriating a publicly and well-known shape, almost as it is, and design that are mere commercial transformation without any aesthetic value. And thirdly, designs that are modified, combined, or used pursuant to creative methods. These three categories of design cannot be registered. And as for commercial and functional transformation, it means that changes are made to the article or its function. As for aesthetic value, whether it will be easily created by an ordinary designer is considered when we determine aesthetic value. And this is an example, sewer pipe anti-odor ceiling plug. Actually, regarding the shape of this item, it does not have creative motive. Regarding the multiple radial cutouts and formation of the lower elastic opening and closing parts, they don't have aesthetic value. And we need to determine whether the applicant's design is modified, combined, or used the creative or express methods commonly used in the field. So we see whether it used a technique or methods that are common in the industry. This is an example with power meter box. It has difference in terms of the number and shape of rain shades and sun shades. So they can be easily modified by an ordinary designer. They simply bisected the shade according to the location of the side glasses. So this case cannot be registered as a design. Lastly, Chuk Ji-young from China.
In China, design 등록 요건으로 정하고 있습니다.
We also have such regulation. Regarding that, I can explain to you in this way.
23조 제2항은 특허권이 부여될 기존 디자인이나 기존 디자인 특징의 조합과 뚜렷이 구별되어야 한다고 규정하고 있습니다.
기존 디자인의 범위에 대해
특허법 제23조 제1항은 기존 디자인은 신상일 우선권이 있으면 우선권일 이전에 국내외에서 대중에게 알려진 디자인을 의미합니다. 신상일 이전에 국내외 사물을 공개적으로 발표 공개적으로 사용 또는 기타 방식으로 일반인에게 알려진 디자인을 포함합니다.
It also includes the design publicly published or publicly known to the ordinary people.
규정 제20조에서 구체적인 판단 기준은 다음과
and
같이
specific,
규정입니다.
Assessment criteria is mentioned in the Chinese
case에 따라
relevant law.
일반 소비자가 쉽게 생각할 수 있는 디자인 특징의 적용, 조합 또는 교체 등의 방식으로 디자인 특허의 전체적인 시각적 효과와 동일하거나
It refers to the visual effect,
실질적으로 동일한 디자인이거나
and if it, 또한 It determines whether they are identical. If they don't have special, specific visual effect, then,
23조 제2항에 명확한 차이가 없음을 인정해야 합니다.
Then it has to recognize whether there's difference between the two designs or not.
존재함을 인정할 수 있습니다. 첫 번째는 같은 종류 물품 중에 다른 부분의 디자인 특징을 조합하거나 교체하는 것. 두 번째는 기존 디자인이 특정 종류 물품의 디자인 특징을 디자인 특허 물품으로 전용하는 것을 공개한 것. 세 번째는 기존 디자인이 다른 특정 종류 물품의 디자인 특징을 서로 조합한 것을 공개한
A combination of different designs.
네 번째는 기존 디자인의 도안을 직접 또는 미세하게만 변경하여
A small change of the existing drawing to be used for the design article.
여섯 번째는 단순하게 기본 기하학적 형상을 사용하거나 미세하게만 조정한 디자인을 얻은 것. 마지막은 일반 소비자가 공지한 건물, 작품, 마크의 정보 또는
designs,
일부를 사용하여 디자인을 얻은 것 이상입니다.
That are well known
예,
to the
감사합니다.
Public.
자, 이번 세션의 마지막 질문인데요. 마지막 질문은 복수의 디자인 형태들 간의 결합에 의한 디자인 이미지 창작을 인정하고 있는지와 그다음에 그 판단 기준이 무엇인지에 대한 것에 대해서 질문을 드리겠습니다. 방금 말씀하셨던 축지영 변호사님 답변 부탁드리겠습니다.
관련 특허법에 따라 간단한 형태의 조합은 특허가 부여되지 않으며 그 판단 기준은 해당 형태의 조합이 독특한 효과를 낼 수 있는지 여부입니다. 중국 특허 심사 가이드의 제4 파트 제5장의 6에 의하면 특허법 제23조 제2항 규정에 따라 특허권이 부여될 디자인은 기존 디자인이나 기존 디자인 특징의 조합과 확연히
In this law, shall mean designs well known in the public domain.
기존 디자인이나 기존 디자인 특징의 조합과 현저하게 차이가 나지 않는 것은
And if there is no significant change between the two designs, that will fall into the following categories.
첫 번째는 사건 관련 특허는 동일 또는 그 유사한 종류의 물품의 기존 디자인과 현저하게 차이가 나지
Firstly,
않는 경우
두 번째는 사건 관련 특허는
기존 디자인에서 적용되고 양자의 디자인 특징이 동일하거나 미세한 차이만 있을 뿐이며 그 구체적인 적용수법은 동일하거나 유사한 종류의 물품의 기존 디자인에서 제시받았을 경우 세 번째는 사건 관련 특허는 기존 디자인 또는 기존 디자인의 특징의 조합으로부터 얻은 것이고
The patent was based on the characteristics of the existing design, and in the case where there's only small difference between the two designs, but are expressed on similar type of article,
정용과 조합을 통해 얻은 사건 관련 특허는
And patent based on the appropriation of the design.
그러나 이와 같은 전용 또는 조합 후에 독특한 시각적 효과를 나타냈을 경우는 제외합니다.
The design has very special visual effect that will not be applied with this rule. I'd like to introduce a case.
관련 그 원고인 선전시 라이트니스 의료유한회사는 디자인 특허권 무효 선고 행정 문제 청구 사건에 불복하여 중국 국가지식재산권국 특허재신위원회가 내린 무효 선고 청구 심사 결정에 대하여 법정 제안에 소송을 제기했습니다. 원고 라이트니스는 다음과 같이 본 특허와 대비 디자인과 뚜렷하게 다르다고 규정했습니다. 양자가 콕과 하트 사이의 덕풍 렌즈, 트림 이미 서로 다릅니다.
They have different shape of trimming. They have different trimming pattern.
And
there was good harmonization of lace trims.
단순한 도형 삭기에 불과합니다. 이에 피고의 판정이 잘못되었습니다. 따라서 원고는 법에 의하여 관련 결정문을 철회하고 다시 결정을 내리도록 청구했습니다. 베이징 베이징 지식재산권 법원은 본토커와 대리 디자인 1의 레이스는 배치가 거의 같기 때문에 꽃 모양의 디자인, 소재, 타임, 순서 등의 측면에서 미세한 차이만 있을 뿐 구체적인 레이스 모양이 다른 것과 부분적인 미세변화에 해당하기 때문에 전체적인 시각적 효과가 없기 때문에 따라서 본토커와 대리 디자인의 차이점 1은 본토커가 기존 디자인에 비해 크게 차별화되는 것이 아닙니다. 원고의 관련 주장은 사실과 법적인 근거 자결, 근거가 부족하여 그래서 이에 대하여 지지하기로 한 지지하지 않기로 했습니다. 이상입니다. 감사합니다.
예, 예. 끝으로 한국의 등교수 부주판사님 답변 드리겠습니다.
예. 휴식 시간은 중요하니까
Actually, you have to take a break. I have to do quickly.
우리 디자인 보호법 33조 2항은 복수 형태 결합에 대한 용의 창조를 규정하고 있다.
Design Protection Act Article 33 says that design may not be registered if it cannot if it can be easily created by an ordinary designer.
창조수 낮은 복수 형태 결합은 이런 유형을 볼 수 있다. 자, 이 부분 좀 보겠습니다. 자 이런 복수 형태 결합에도 참가수 낮은 디자인 있을 수 있는데
If there's a design made by combining multiple forms, it should be determined along with whether the combination is easy.
먼저 디자인 분야에 따라서는 그 발상의 자유가 제한되는 측면이 있으니까
First, in terms of the domain of design, we should consider the relevance. The first thing we have to consider is
형태의 알려진 분야를 첫째 고려 요소로 합니다.
Whether the articles of known designs or known fields of well-known forms exist.
디자인의 특성으로 응용될 수 있을 있다는 것이 암시될 정도의 그런 디자인들
And relevancy must be present between designs so as to suggest that the exterior with ornamental characteristics of a design can be applied as the characteristics of another. And thirdly, for the trend in the field, may influence the range from which designs may be selected.
자 그래서 사례를 하나 보면
So this is an example.
메트리얼 포장 용기에 관한
That's coil egg carton, as you see here.
남자 모양의 형상이 주요한 차이점이 있습니다.
They have difference in terms of the form. The hemisphere shape is well known form in the packaging industry. And if you look at the prior design, the inside space of the prior design has common characteristics with the well known form. So we can determine that there's no special creative efforts required to make this create this design. Thank you for your attention.
이상으로 세션 주제에 대한 질문 답변 모두 마치겠습니다.
We have finished Q&A.
다시 한번 감사드리고요.
Thank you very much for your
자, 마치기 전에 시간은 거의 다 됐지만 특허시청 실무에 관해서 아주 중요한 말씀을 해주시게 나와주셨는데요. 너무 또 오랫동안 기다려주시게 해서 죄송하긴 한데 아까 소개해드린 특허청의 김지맹 과장님으로부터 화상 디자인 보호에 관한 한국 특허청 심사 실무라는 주제로 발표를 청해 듣겠습니다. 예, 과장님 발표 부탁드립니다.
안녕하십니까. 특허청 디자인심사과장으로
I'm Jimin Kim, Director of Home and Daily Goods Design Examination Division of Korean Intellectual Property Office. This slide shows content of my presentation. Due to time constraint, I may have to skip some slides that contain general information, so please refer to the reference book for the information. photos and cases from
KAPO Keepers
design examination criteria. There have been few GUI disputes in Korea. Most of administrative boards trials or trials against rejection. There are almost no cases filed as suit with the patent court for the administrative decision. Few trials on invalidation or trials to confirm scope of rights were claimed. Almost no civil or criminal cases were found. Whether it is ideal or not for the society is a different topic for discussion, but I felt it would have been more helpful in developing institutions to handle GUI if there were claims to discuss.
GUI
has been protected since 2003 when the design examination guidelines were revised. Since then, about 1,700 patents for GUI are applied every year. Design should be for an article of a manufacturer to be protected by the Design Protection Act. GUI itself is not protected as design. But it is protected as a shape displayed on the surface under the premise of the article with a display, such as the smartphones. As you can see on the slide, there are many examples of GUI. There are GUI of a website or smartphone and a home appliance. Icons, backgrounds, or characters can be registered as design if they meet certain requirements. In recent years, application of patents for animated GUI have been But if the design is not for an article manufacturer, it is not likely the design is registered. If the display cannot specify within the article like a virtual keyboard and is projected by light, the design cannot be registered. And the shape of article the GUI is displayed is not clearly illustrated. The design cannot be registered. However, if a displaying part is added and the application is filed at the display panel, the GUI the application may be registered. In the meantime, there has been discussion the Design Protection Act is not sufficiently protecting GUI in various forms generated by AR and VR. In this regard, the National Assembly discussed the pending revision of the Act. The revised act allows registration of GUI itself, but the registration is limited to GUI used for operation of a device and GUI displayed as a result of a function. Application of GUI is required to describe the category and name of the GUI according to Locarno classification. The name of GUI is described as display panel with GUI to expand the scope of rights.
For your information,
let me compare Locarno classification, original classification of articles. Screen displays and icons that fall into number 14 and graphic symbols that fall into number 32 under the Locarno classification are not recognized as a design in Korea. For practical examination, one patent application for design is not a problem, but it could be a problem for animated GUI. As for animated GUI, there should be physical relevance and transformation consistency for it to be recognized as design.
In these pictures,
they are using the same frame, but their shapes and arrangement of components are different, so they are not recognized as the same design.
And recently,
the one design,
this principle
has been applied these days,
but actually,
it is highly likely that the design subject application in this one will be recognized.
판단은 일반적인 디자인과 큰 차이는 없습니다.
Actually,
다만 실무적으로 다른 물품에 비해서 심사관이 직접 선행 디자인을 검색해서 찾아내는 것 자체가 다른 물품에 비해서 굉장히 어렵다는 점 특징을 보여주고 있습니다.
But the design examination guidelines include the following, considering the characteristics of the GUI.
In this case, in
the overall composition and layout, especially the location and shape of the axis, is similar to the prior design. But the intellectual property trial and appeal board said that the icon is generally well known, and the shape of the button and the combined shape and form of the applied design are different from the prior design.
First,
there are designs that partially transformed the publicly known design or that made a simple combination of publicly known design. Secondly, easy creation based on well-known shape, especially
the 이러한
common UI design or very basic layout, or if it's a combination of simple shapes like circles and rectangles, then they are
이 사례는 좀 생략을 하고요.
Here,
보시면 트론 디자인은 디스플레이 모서리 부분에 공지된 동영상 재생 아이콘을 단순하게 배치한 것입니다. 사건에서 트론 디자인의 아이콘 모양은 특이성이 인정되지 않는다. 그러나 아이콘을 특정한 위치에 배치한 것에서 특이성을 인정한다.
Is not recognized in the applied design, but the arrangement of the icon in certain locations is recognized for its uniqueness.
So these days,
requirements for designs that are not easily created became softened compared to before. Next is design application for GUI accompanied claim made priority. The method of protecting GUI differs by country, so if the applied design is not identical with the representation of the first filing, the approval of the priority could be determined by taking the practice of the first filing office into consideration. Whether or not the applied design in the first country and the applied design in Korea are identical to each other is being flexibly assessed. Lastly, I'd like to introduce you a case. Due to time constraint, here plaintiff is Apple, defendant is Samsung Electronics. In this case, the court compared the design of plaintiff and the design of defendant. Although the arrangement of icons may be similar, specific shape of individual icons is different. So here, the specific shape of individual icons cannot be considered similar to the plaintiff's design. For more details, please read the presentation materials. As mentioned before, patent application requirements for computer-generated graphic design have been alleviated compared to before. I hope that this would technically help designers and companies protect their computer-generated graphic design.
예, 감사합니다. Thank you for your attention. 아직 소송법적으로는 좀 낯선 화상 디자인이지만 자세하고 상세한 내용 다시 한번 감사드리고요. 말씀하신 개정안이 시행되면 사건도 같이 늘어나지 않을까 생각합니다. 순서상으로는 좀 토론하긴 한데요. 지금 다들 토론하는 거니까 토론보다는 커피가 필요하시죠.
혹시라도 안 계시죠?
정 못 찾겠다 하시는 분은 앞에 계신 분한테 개인적으로 오시면 친절히 답변해 드릴 것으로 확인됩니다. 그럼 이것으로 3 세션을 마치고요. 이번 세션 통해서 디자인 소송에 대해서 보다 깊이 이해할 수 있는 기회가 되었길 바라고 끝으로 멀리 연구해서 참석해 주신 빌 변호사님과 여기 계신 모든 패널분들께 다시 한번 큰 박수 부탁드리겠습니다.
Thank you, speakers and panels, and the
예, 감사합니다.
Judge from UK.
이것으로
Thank you
세 번째
all.
세션을 모두 마치겠습니다. 발표를 진행해 주신 연사분과 윤성식 부장님께 다시 한번 감사드리며 잠시 휴식 시간을 가지신 후 4시 30분부터 마지막 세션을 진행하겠습니다. 코로나 19